Good morning, everybody. How you doing? It's good to see you. Man, you guys look awesome this morning. I just want to ask, this is Bob, right? What did you do, man? Nobody's sitting beside you. Did you offend somebody? Oh, you are a Florida State fan. Oh, I'm sorry. I had to do that, man. I'm sorry, man. That's a rough loss last night. Oh, man, I didn't mean to. Yeah, I shouldn't have done that. Will you forgive me? Maybe I'll buy you lunch or something. All right, so good to have you today. We're doing a series on money. Turn to someone and say, money. Y'all didn't say that very excitedly, did you? Oh, man, we're talking about money. Now, money is not evil. It's not good. For crying out loud, it's paper. Money doesn't have a personality. Money doesn't have a nature. It's just paper. We use it as a source of trading, and it's something that we just trade with each other. In the verse of 1 Timothy chapter 6, it's at the top of your notes, and you guys can download the notes at Bulletin Plus. It's an app on your phone, and scroll down to Go Church, click on it, and guess what? Your notes show up, the worship program will show up, and all the announcements will show up there. It's really a cool app if you want to use it. And so this is what 1 Timothy 6:10 says. All right, I want you to sound out, everybody, that third word, okay? For the
love.
For the
love.
Okay, for the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. It sounds a lot like about what Dave was talking about just recently, right? It says that the love of money, when money becomes my obsession, there is something that happens. It says that it's a root. When you talk about root, it's down there deep. Roots are things that you don't necessarily see, but it's what fuels the fire. It's what fuels the growth. It's what fuels. And it says the root of all kinds of evil. You know what I take away from this verse? It's that you have to be very, very careful when it comes to money. And make sure that money does not grab a hold of your heart. Doesn't that make sense? Because we want only one thing to have a hold of our hearts. We want only one thing to have our hearts, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. Because Matthew 22 says to love God with all of your heart. See, God's a jealous God, and when we love money, it becomes an idol in our life. So we've been going through the ABCs of financial freedom, and we're praying. I am praying for you that you will find freedom in this series. We're doing this because we're just burdened for the state of affairs. Last week, we talked about the attitude towards finances, and our attitude that a lot of us demonstrate is that it's mine. I work hard for it. I've lived all my life to get to this point, and my money is mine. And that's just point blank. That is not a biblical perspective. What we looked at last week is that we saw in God's word that everything, us included, everything is the Lord's. And that he was the one that created it, and he created it for his glory. We're not our own. Money is not ours. Everything that we give, have been given, has been trusted to us to glorify him. We are stewards of his money. So that when we look at, we are possessing money that's not our own, that we're to use it with wisdom and with stewardship. We understand that we don't own it, that ownership versus possession. I want us to look at a very, very important proverb in Proverbs 22:7. Proverbs 22:7 says this: the rich rule over the poor. That's not the focus of what I want to focus on, but listen to the second part of that wisdom proverb. And the borrower is slave to the lender. The borrower is slave to the lender. What it's saying there in wisdom scripture is that when we borrow, we become slaves. And many of us in this room, just being truthful, we feel that pressure. We feel that stress. We feel how weighted down we are by that burden of finances and debt. Can I say this morning? That being in debt with no way to pay it off quickly is not God's will. It is not God's will for your life. You know, there's a story that I think really, if you'll follow with me, really speaks to this situation. And it really is about the people of Israel. It's an Old Testament story. And do you remember the story of Joseph, how he was sold into slavery by his brothers because they were envious of how much Joseph had and how his dad treated him, and remember the coat of many colors and the robe of many colors, and they threw him in a pit and they sold him off, and Joseph was put into slavery where? He was sold where? He was in Potiphar's house, and Joseph was in slavery, and God allowed him to raise up and to be in a high position as a servant. And he came up with this strategy and this way of saving nations by the way he store the food. And so this huge famine went across the land, and people were dying, and people didn't know it was coming. And these people in Pharaoh and in Egypt, they stored up all this food, so everybody was coming there to live off the famine. Now, the people of Israel was only supposed to be there for how long was the famine? Maybe 7 years? But here's the problem, is that they got comfortable living off of someone else's money, proceeds, food. They lived off of somebody else's money, and you know what it led to? It led to 400 years of slavery. 400 years that on their back, they were beaten. On their back, they built lots of the cities for the Egyptians, and on their back in sweat and tears, they forgot their promises from God. They forgot that God promised that he would give them a promised land. And we know who was raised up to lead them out of there. It was Moses, right? But look at Exodus chapter 1, and that's the background to this story in Exodus chapter 1, verse 6. It says, now Joseph and all of his brothers and all that generation died. But the Israelites were exceedingly fruitful. They multiplied greatly, increased in numbers, and became so numerous that the land was filled with them. Then a new king, to whom Joseph meant nothing, came to power in Egypt. Verse 9. Look, he said to his people, these Israelites have become far too numerous for us. Come, we must deal shrewdly with them, or they will become even more numerous, and if war breaks out, will join our enemies, fight against us, and leave the country. So they put slave masters over them. This is so sad. They put slave masters over them to oppress them with forced labor. And they built Pithom and Ramesses as store cities for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread. So the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites and worked them ruthlessly. They made their lives bitter with harsh labor in brick and mortar and with all kinds of work in the fields. In all their harsh labor, the Egyptians worked them ruthlessly. Why did the Egyptians be put in slavery? Why did they allow themselves to be in slavery? Because they wouldn't fight for the promises of God, and they wouldn't leave this foreign land and go home. They wouldn't embrace what God had for them, and they chose an easy way for themselves because they were being fed, they were being taken care of, and they were comfortable. You know, this picture right here reminds me of America. I mean, just think about how many credit card applications you get in the mail in 1 month. I mean, I could give you a stack of those credit card applications that we receive in our home each month because we got a college student in our house, and they're the ones that they go after. That's a lot of them, and then a lot of them is for Christina and I. I mean, credit card debt is in epidemic proportions today. I was looking and doing some research. Do you know what the average credit card debt that most people have in America? What is the average? You got any idea? It is $8,000 on credit card. In a household with a husband and wife, it's $16,000. Do you know what most students graduate college with? They graduate with a degree and with $31,000 average of student loans. Debt. And do you know what? I found this interesting. In Florida, people average owe $15,500 on their car. People are barely keeping their nose above water, and they're in bondage, and debt is strangling the life out of the family and out of individuals, and I hate it, and God hates it, and I know you do too. It's got to change, because God does have a promised land for his people. God doesn't want this pressure and this stress. Do you know, I was absolutely blown away by two occasions this last couple weeks. I was at Wawa. I don't have a clue where they came up with that name, by the way. I think they were offering their kids something to drink, and the kids said Wawa, and that's how they came up with the name of their gas station. I was in line, and I was behind this guy, and he gave the teller a credit card, and they swiped it, and he put in a number, and it said, didn't work. So he pulled another one out of it. He pulled out three different cards, and it was the third card that actually worked. The other two were denied. That's not the worst of it. I was at Walmart. I hate to go to Walmart. I try to go in the middle of the night. And you know what? If I go in the middle of the night, I can't get in between the rows. I'm a big guy because they're putting stuff out. I believe Walmart's of the devil. But anyway, I was at Walmart, and this person, this woman, you know, bought two grocery carts of food. I think that's a great thing, and had all these things in it. That's fine. You know, it's really odd to look at what people buy at Walmart. Have you ever done that, saw them what they buy? Say, you're going to eat that? You're going to wear that? Really? But anyway, she pulled out of her large suitcase, I mean her purse, this, like, what I thought, man, what's she going to pull her CD case out for? You know those little black CD cases that have a zipper and you stick your CDs in the pouches? Well, this thing was not a CD case. It was like a credit card holder. I've never seen anything like it in my life. She pulled it out, plumped it down on the counter, and she opened it up, unzipped it, and she was going page to page, and every one of those pages were filled with credit card. And she pulled one out, tried it, didn't work, pulled another one out, tried it, didn't work. Then she pulled out and said, aha. I mean, after like the fifth card, it was a Walmart card. I mean, she had a card from, it seemed like, everywhere. I mean, she had a McDonald's credit card. It seemed like she had everything, but it was pages, and it was funny. But can I tell you, that is so sad. Because God's word tells us that when we live in credit debt, that we're in bondage. We're in bondage. It breaks my heart. Let me share with you some realities about debt. And what breaks my heart about debt. Number one, fill in the blank, please. Debt obligates us to someone other than God. You know, it's like being married. It's like being connected. It's like being chained to. When you owe somebody a debt, it's like you are obligated to them. You know, it's like, have you ever borrowed money from somebody and you didn't have the money to pay them back and you see them? You walk the other way. It's like, I mean, have you ever done that? You remember that feeling? You know, what about the feeling when you know you haven't made your credit card payment and you're late on it and you're getting a call and you don't recognize the number? You know what you feel like? You feel like, okay, here they come again. I'm not answering that. See, the reality of debt is that debt obligates us to someone other than God. And the Bible says that we are to not be obligated to others. Number two, here's the honest truth from God's word, not from me. I'm not saying this. This is what God's word says. Debt without repayment is sin. Debt without repayment is sin. In Psalms 37:21, it says this. Psalms 37:21, the wicked borrow and do not repay, but the righteous give generously. Now, which one do you want to be? It says the wicked is the one that borrows and doesn't repay, but the righteous, they are givers and they give generously. When we borrow and don't repay, God puts it on our account as sin. It breaks his heart. It breaks our relationship with him. So number one, debt obligates us to someone other than God. Two, debt without repayment is sin. Number three, debt is something God wants us out of. He wants us to get out of the pits of debt. Plain and simple, God wants us to be on a trajectory of moving away from debt. You know, in Deuteronomy chapter 28, this is what it says. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 28. This is a powerful passage. In Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 12, it says, the Lord will open the heavens and storehouses of his bounty to do what? To send rain on your land and seize it, and to bless all the work of your hands. You will lend to many nations, but will borrow from none. That's what God promises us if we do things his way. Verse 13, the Lord will make you the head, not the tail. If you pay attention to the commands of the Lord your God that I give you this day and carefully follow them, you will always be at the top and never at the bottom. Do not turn aside from any of the commands I give you today, to the right or to the left, following other gods and serving them. Man, God says very plainly that he wants to prosper us. He wants to bless us. He wants us to put us on display that God's hand is on our life, that his blessings are on us. But we have got to make decisions. We have got to live our life according to his statutes and commands. His commands are not to be burdensome. His way of living and the way that God has given us his path and his word, that he wants us to have the best path. He wants us to have the blessed path. And when we choose to get in credit card debt, this is what we say to God. God, you have provided X amount for me, and I appreciate that. But God, I know better than you. I know at what financial level my family should live at. And I know how my kids should dress. I know what kind of car I should drive, and I know what kind of home I should live in, and I know what kind of out to eat, and we're supposed to go to movies, even when we don't have the money. And I want to live at this level, God, because I know better than you at what level I should live at. So we do cha-ching. We live on the cha-ching. We live on credit card debt. And can I tell you, it is a devil-induced fantasy that will always come back to bite you and your children and your marriage. And that's what we don't want to see. God promises if you'll follow him that he'll make you the head and not the tail. He'll make you on top and not the bottom. And what is that really, really talking about? The principle is that God wants us to be the lenders. God wants us to be the givers. God doesn't want us to be the borrowers and the takers. He wants us to be generous. And when you are in bondage and debt, you cannot be generous. You cannot be a giver. And number four, let me make this point. In the Bible, debt was limited to only 7 years. The principles in the Bible, is that debt should only be for 7 years. What does that tell us? That there should not be an indebtedness without a plan to quickly pay it off. See, you know, to be honest, and I believe God understands that, and he makes allowances for some types of debt. I mean, if you are going to buy a house, not many of us in our lifetime could save the money to buy a house cash-wise. It's okay to get some debt. I don't think it's okay to get 100% debt of the house value. Have equity. And listen to this. I did a study of this. This is very interesting. Buying a house illustration is what I call it. Do you know if you buy a house for $200,000 and you put it on a 30-year note, with the amortization, you're going to pay over 30 years $333,000 for that house. You're going to pay $133,000 in interest. You take the same note, $200,000 for a house, and you do it for 15 years. You know how much you're going to pay for that house? You're going to pay $275,000. You cut the years in half, you cut the interest in half. You end up saving almost $75,000. But if you break it down to 10 years, you'll pay back $248,000. But if you bring it down to 7 years, you end up paying $238,000 for that house. And what they say, probably what happens in 7 years, because the property values, you'll be paying actually less than what the house is worth. It's a better deal. And notice that you have cut $100,000 off of your interest. Now think about it. See, God doesn't want us to be in bondage and debt. And bondage and debt is being in debt way over your head with no plan, with no rule, no way to pay it off. And I just encourage you this morning to think through that. To think through what God would have you do. The fifth point that I wanted to make is that debt pushes us to rely on something other than God. Isn't that the point? Isn't that the point? That we're relying on creditors, and we're relying on their grace, and we're relying on what we're going to get paid tomorrow, and we rob Paul to pay, we rob Peter to pay Paul, and we're doing all this debt stuff. I didn't want to just talk about the bondage today without talking about some bondage breakers. See, our heart is not just to bring up the problem, our heart is to help you. And matter of fact, let me say this, that our desire is to help you walk through finances so that you can find freedom. And not find freedom only in your finances, but in every avenue of your life, in your parenting, in your marriage, in your workplace, in every aspect of your life, your thought life, in your finances, that God would bring freedom to you. So let's look at some debt bondage breakers. It all starts, number one, fill in the blank, with a commitment to God. And that commitment is saying, God, I understand your heart in this issue. And I understand that my lifestyle and the life that I'm choosing is a life of sin, and that it's leading me and my family to slavery. And I want to make a commitment today to change my attitude and to change my mind and to change my lifestyle to do things your way, not the way of the world. Look what Romans 13 says. In verse 8, Romans 13, 8, let no debt remain outstanding. God hates debt. He doesn't want us in it. Except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. So let's make a commitment to God that through your grace and through your strength that I'm going to be not a taker, but I'm going to be a giver and not a lender. I mean, not a borrower, but a lender. That I'm going to have the mind of Christ when it comes to my money. Number two, fill in the blank, stop the bleeding. Immediately stop the bleeding. Perform plastic surgery. Cut the cord. You'll never get out of the hole unless you stop digging. You have got to stop renewing and you've got to stop building new debt. You have got to get out of that trap. So today, cut the cord. Today, stop the digging. Today, stop the bleeding. Some of the things that we need to do, we need to get our debt transferred to a consolidation or another card with a lower interest. But don't extend the balance. Don't extend the available balance. Number three. It sounds simple, but it's so true. I'm telling you, this principle is a life changer. Put God first in your finances. So many times we have that turned upside down. We pay debt collector A, we pay debt collector B, we pay debt collector through Z. And we get to the end, and if we have anything left over, we give to God. Can I tell you, when we pay God with our leftovers, come on, hear me, go church. Is anybody hearing me this morning? See, when we pay God with our leftovers, we're treating him that way. We're putting him as that priority in our life. We need to give God his due and trust him with it in the first place. That put God first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and the promises, all these things shall be added unto you. You will get out of debt because you put God first. Trust him with your money. Trust him. Number four, you have to develop a written plan with a time frame. You have to write it down. And part of writing it down is called a budget. How you're going to build guardrails in your financial life so that you don't continue to run off the road. And we want to help you with that. And matter of fact, let me stop and say this right now. We made an investment in the last couple of weeks. And what I did is the book that I'm using to bring this series that I'm studying, you know, I study that book, God's Word, but I get some ideas and illustrations from men who are godly men and write on subjects that are much smarter than me, so I glean from them. And what I'm gleaning for this series is from a book by Barry Cameron called The ABCs of Financial Freedom. Now, this book is an expensive book. It's worth something. And you know what, I could ask you, would you pay me $15 the cost of this book? But you know what God said in my heart? How are they ever going to be generous unless you demonstrate it, Barry? So what I've done is I bought 100 of these books. And for one per family today, we are going to sow a seed into you. And we're going to give you this book for absolutely free. So when you walk out the door today in the lobby, these books are available and they're free. It's our gift to you. It's our gift to bless your finances. As a matter of fact, it is a seed that this church is sowing into each one of you. And here's what I would ask. Don't take it if you don't intend to read it. Don't let this book, this material that your church bought with precious money that people have given, and just let it sit on the shelf. If you're not going to read it, just leave it and just walk on by. But if you will take this, one of the things you can do for your finances is just to pray and ask God to speak through you and get some help financially through reading this book. Do the work. It's easy to get in debt. It takes hard work to get out. And this book will help you. And matter of fact, with that said, this guy has a workbook to go with it. And what I'd like to do 1 week from this Wednesday, on Wednesday night, I'd like to start a class called the ABCs of Financial Freedom. And I'd like to work through the workbook with you for several weeks on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, and I need to know, because we need to get the workbooks, if you want help, read the book, attend the class, and we are willing to do whatever it takes as a church to help you. If you want to attend that class, email info@gochurch.org or write on your connection card this morning that I'd like to attend the class. On the back of it, I would like to attend the financial freedom class. Pastor Barry, I'll be there next Wednesday. And I'll get you a book and you can pay me back for the workbook. But I'm going to sow this book in your life. Is that a blessing or what? Well, I'll just tell you this. If it doesn't work for you, you can bring the book back and I'll give you your money back. I'll give you everything that you paid for it back, okay? Since we're giving it to you. And baby, we're talking about financial freedom. So we're going to give you the book for free. Sounds like a good deal? Number 5, let's really do this. Let's adjust our lifestyle. Let's adjust our lifestyle. And let's stop trying to live like the rich and famous. And let's live like a disciple of Christ. We may need to cut the cable off. We may need to cut the internet off. We may need to drive a less expensive car. We may need to wear the shoes a little bit longer. We have got to change our lifestyle to get out of debt and make that hard decision. And the last point that I wanted to make is number 6. It's develop a system to get out of debt, and we call it the debt snowball. And I'd like to show you how to do it because it's worked for me and my wife. And it's worked for many, many people. Dave Ramsey teaches it. Barry Cameron teaches it. It's a great process. And basically, let me give you the short of it. Is you take your credit card that has the least amount on it and pay that off first. You get crazy, radical, and you pay that off. And so what you do after you pay that one off is you take the payment of what you were paying that credit card to just pay the minimum fee, and you apply it to the next credit card. You don't pocket that and say, oh man, I got the freedom of another $100 in my budget. No, you don't, because you have debt. So the next credit card that you have that has the smallest amount on it, you apply that $100 of what you were paying on that credit card to that credit card. Does that make sense? And so it becomes a snowball. As you pay off credit cards, you apply what you're paying minimum balances on all the credit cards, and there'll be a day that you'll come up here and say, Pastor Barry, I'm free! You know, man, bondage thing. We kid about it. We laugh about it. We clap about it. But it's a real thing, and it's tearing up marriages. It's tearing families apart. It's tearing people apart. It's making people feel like there is no hope. And that's not true. It is the lie of Satan that there is no hope. There is hope for you. And we are willing to do whatever it takes as a church to help you. But the bottom line, seriously, the bottom line is that you have got to be willing to help yourself. You've got to step out. You've got to cut the cord. You've got to change your lifestyle. You've got to pray together as a husband and wife. Do you know that the number one reason for divorce is financial fussing? Arguing over money? Do you really want to continue to financially live like the world? Think about it. Think about it. What could we as a family of God do for the kingdom of God if our finances was freed up? I mean, the lives we could impact, the towns overseas on mission trips that we could impact, the building we could build, the ministry we could have together. Honestly, the reason why we don't have a building, we're not going to do it until God opens the door. We're not going to kick a door down ourselves and find some loan and find some bondage ourselves. We don't mind getting in debt for a building as long as it makes sense and we got a plan to pay for it. But I'm not going to get in debt, and we're not going to get way over heels so that our arms are shackled together and we can't do ministry because we're married to a building. We're going to get a building one day because it's for the glory of God and it's going to radiate His provision, not bondage for this church. If you're sitting there and you need hope, hope is found in one place. It's looking in the eyes of Jesus. And today, I would encourage you to lift your head. Don't feel condemnation from this service or this sermon. Don't feel the condemnation. Feel the hope and the hand that's reaching out to help you. And that hand is Jesus, that He wants that relationship with you. He wants to lead you beside still waters. He wants to guide you and shepherd you and take care of you like a loving shepherd. But it takes taking your eyes off of the things of this world and the false hopes and dreams of this world that will always leave you broke, leave you hopeless, and leave you destroyed. And say, I'm going to put my eyes on a prize that's not just for today, but it's for all of eternity. And I'm going to turn to God. I'm asking you this morning to turn to God. If you're here and you don't know if you have a relationship with God, the Bible says that we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, that we need to admit that and ask God to forgive us. Number two, we must believe in God's provision that He sent His Son to pay the penalty of our sins and so that we can have a relationship with Him. We must believe that Jesus is God's Son, that He's the only way to heaven, that He died for our sins, and that He rose from the grave, and that He defeated everything, death, the devil, sin, everything. He is victorious, and He wants you to join His family. And the way we do that, admit, believe, see, confess. Making a commitment. I receive Jesus as Lord of my life. The boss, the master. Have you ever done that? Well, if you haven't, what are you waiting for? That is the treasure. That is the real prize. With your eyes closed and your heads bowed all over this place, If you have never received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the Bible says today is the day of salvation. You are free indeed. If you want a relationship with God, would you pray something like this? Dear God, I know that you created me. I know that you love me. And I know that you want a relationship with me. And God, I just admit, I've sinned. I've had an attitude of going my way, not your way, and doing my life and things my way, not your way. And I'm sorry. I admit it. Please forgive me. And God, I'm so thankful that you love me enough to send your best in Jesus, your Son. I believe in him. I believe he's the only way to heaven. I believe that he died for my sins and that only through his precious blood can I have forgiveness of sins. He paid it all. And I believe that he overcame the grave, and I believe he overcame death. I believe he overcame hell and sin when you rose him from the grave, that he is alive. So Jesus, because you are alive, I invite you into my life, my world, my finances, my heart. And I ask you to be my Savior, to save me from myself and my sin. And I ask that you would be my Lord, the boss and controller and authority of my life right now. Help me to live every day, every moment for you. I surrender my life to you in Jesus' name. I pray. Amen. With your eyes still closed and heads still bowed, don't lift your heads. Don't look around. Between you and me and God, if you pray that prayer, two things. Please fill out the connection card. Please check the box on the back and let us know. Let us pray for you. If you pray that prayer and you meant business with God, you were sincere. You're not playing games. I want to pray for you. If that's you and you pray that prayer for the first time and you meant it, would you just slip up your hand right now all over this place? Just raise your hand right now. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Anyone else? Anyone else? All over this place. Thank you. Let's get real, people of God. If you're here and you say, Pastor Barry, God is speaking to me about my finances. And I need your prayers, Pastor Barry. Would you just raise your hand? God is speaking to me about my finances. Would you just raise your hand? God sees your hand. He knows your heart. Would you please stand with me, everyone in this room? Let's stand to our feet. Father God, you know the needs in this room. You know the hurts. You know the struggles. And God, you know those who are in financial bondage. And you know those in our community, our city, that are in financial bondage that need help, God. I just pray that you would meet them right where they're at and that they would turn to you. Turn to you, Lord. Turning to you is repentance. God, help them to repent over their lifestyle. And it's a lifestyle of selfishness. Help them to turn to you and ask for forgiveness, Lord, and get right with you, Lord. God, I thank you for those who prayed today to receive you as Lord and Savior. God, bless them, protect them, help them to grow in their relationship with you. Lord, bless them. God, I pray against what the enemy would try to do in marriages, in people's relationship with you. People cannot go to church on Sundays in this community because they have to work every day of the week to pay their debt, Lord. I pray against that, Lord. I've had people tell me face to face, I can't afford to go to church because I need to work. God, help us in this room to put you first in our finances, Lord. Help us in this community to honor you with our time, with our talents, and with our treasures, God. Help us in this city to put you first in all that we do, God. Help us, oh Lord. We're crying out to you, God. We want to make ourselves available to be used by you and to demonstrate your character of generosity to this world, Lord. Help us. Forgive us. Free us, Lord Jesus. Forgive us, God, when we chase things that are not you. God, may we only be chasers of God. May we not chase any dreams of this world, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. It's the band that's going to lead us in a very powerful song. I know this beyond a shadow of a doubt because the Lord has laid it on my heart that many of you guys, you need to come to this altar and get some things right with God, whatever it is. This altar is for you. And if you feel the tug of the Holy Spirit, don't you stay there where you're standing. If you feel the tug of the Holy Spirit, maybe you don't know why he's tugging you. Come anyway to honor him. If you need someone to pray with you, there'll be prayer warriors here. If you need me to pray with you, I'll be here. But let's give the Lord his will in our lives right now. As the band leads us, you come.